Hi, this is Brian Wilson with BFW Classroom, and today we're going to look at personalizing stock photos from Adobe Spark to create custom backgrounds. To create the look you see in front of you, I've taken two different stock photos and dropped them on the workplace. One is the wood background, and the other one's a stock photo of some tablets, but I also dropped in all the key stickers or pictures that I want to add to create the personalized piece. The wood grain background is the back, and I just put in wood texture to give me this sort of tabletop look that I wanted, and then apply that to the background directly. The other piece with the tablet that you see here was actually picked because I wanted three different pieces of technology to kind of look on there. I have a notebook, a pen, a tablet, a keyboard, an Apple keyboard, and I wanted those to make a second or third layer inside of the thing, inside of the picture. So I put in tablet. There's a couple of different choices. I did like this one. I almost picked it, but it didn't look right, but I did like this one because it has a nice background that's flat. So it makes the remove background tool that much easier to use. So you can see here, we're just going to get rid of that. Now, once you drop in, you could crop just to get the pieces that you want to, but these have odd lines to them. So by cropping it, you won't get the sort of double layer. You won't get this on top of the wood texture like you need to. You actually want to remove the background from the piece. So make sure you click the button, click the picture, and you'll see we're going to take all these and move them here in a second, but click on the picture. Go to remove background, and then once you select it, it will auto-generate and pull this out. Now, I will say this, once you do that, you're gonna have to wanna fill it up. You might find some of the stock photos not remove the background the way you want to, so try a couple different ones. You also need to make sure that you have your edges. So to make sure you have clean edges, I created a border on mine, so it'll give me a little bit I can see. So like here, you can see on the edge, I didn't get it all the way there with the actual part. If you do add it to the background after you've layered it, it creates two different cells. You don't want to do that. You're just going to put this layer, you're creating multiple layers on that tabletop background that you began with. Now again, you could do this with something else. Like let's say you want to put a table in front of a wall, or you want to put stickers on something. You could use anything for your background layer that you want to. Now I have this problem. I have all of these stickers, and I want to make sure that they lay underneath the other pieces. If I select them all, it ends up selecting the stickers and the other pieces there. So one way to undo that selection is hold the shift key and click on the piece that you don't want to. So now I have just the stickers selected. And if I move them, I'll be able to sort of do some things with that. I want to ungroup as well, so I pre-group them after I dropped them in. Just so it was easy to sort of move them around at one point. But now that I see them on there, that doesn't really work for me. So what I want to do is I'm going to see what happens when I drop them down. So now it looks like the stickers have been applied directly to the wood grain top. And as you can see, I only have a couple of choices. I can make them larger or smaller as one whole group. I can't select just one. And if I double click, since I have this top layer over it, it actually selects the top layer and not the sticker. So what I'm going to have to do again is take this top layer, now that I have it in place, and I need to push it to the background again. So I'm going to go back over to my layering tool, which is right here, click the bottom part, which again will lay it on top of the formatted background that I've already selected, and then begin to move each of the stickers to a point on the table that I kind of want them to be at. I want to sort of lay them on top of things. I want the tablet, the keyboard, the pen, the notebook to look like they're laying on top of the table. And then these stickers that I've created lay on the actual table itself. I want those to be the pieces that sort of create this personalized 3D look to the stock photography. Now, once I'm done, I'll end up doing a couple of different things. So I'll move these around. I may like them, I may not like them where they are. But now that I'm done, I'm going to click the tablet set, and I'm going to push that all the way back up to the top. So now you can see all of those pieces are laying on top of the stickers. All the shadows that were associated with them went away as well. But one of the stickers is off the actual scene and covering my border, and I didn't want that. So if I click on it again, I have this trouble where, again, I have that top layer. It is the whole sheet. It's the whole workspace. So even if I kind of do the trick where I create a grab tool and select just it, and then unselect the other one, it's still going to move that. So you're going to have to be patient when you're creating the layers if you don't put your sticker layer or your personalized layer on correctly the first time. You might have to go back and forth and push that top layer to the background and the top layer to the foreground a couple of times to get them where you want them to be. Okay, so again, formatting, putting some stuff in there. I'm going to take that foreground piece, push it all the way back up to the top. So now it looks like my stickers are on the table. And I do almost the exact same piece on that repeat sticker that you see there by using just icons. I created a background and then I dropped in the different letters using the icon set to build the word repeat. So I did R with sign language, those block E's, the at sign, a P, which was sort of like this formatting set, and then the T I used the, I originally used one of the block T's, and I really didn't like that. And then I went back, I wanted sort of this like engineering look to it. So I found, see that the block T there, I ended up going with the T square, which looks a little bit better. And I do like the fact that in the repeat, there's three E's and they're all the same color, all the same size. So it kind of has that little like double layering of styling there. Hope this helps you build and personalize backgrounds and customize stock photos that you find inside of Adobe Spark. Hey, don't forget to hit the subscribe button there on the right, or click on the video above to see one of the other tutorials I've made. Again, this is Brian Wilson. Thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoyed.